Hello world, this is Praveen Suryavanshi, your virtual guide for the journey into the space and time. The wonders of the sky have attracted the human mind and it has been studied from the beginning of civilization. The night sky hasn't changed much over that time, but over the past few hundreds of years, our understanding of it has changed. The sheer activity of looking at the cosmos and trying to understand it came to be recognized as a science after the ancient Greeks developed astronomy, which they treated as a branch of mathematics. In India, it was the Siddhantic period when Aryabhatta penned and published the Arya Siddhanta, which laid the foundation of astronomy as a science in the subcontinent. From ancient Greek sky observers to Aryabhatta and a number of other astronomers over time who contributed to astronomy were all amateurs. The word amateur means involvement in work for pleasure and knowledge rather than a profession. Amateur astronomers during Mughal era prepared numerous astronomical tables of planetary movements called Zi in Arabic. Maharaja Jai Singh of Jaipur applied his knowledge on mathematics and astronomical tables to construct Jantar Mantars across India. These architectural marvels were designed to accurately measure the positions and movement of celestial objects, which help in keeping track of time and publish Panchangas, which was the Indian calendar and almanac. Maharaja Jai Singh was an amateur astronomer and mathematician himself. Over the ages, astronomy was purely practiced through naked observations, and few scholars replicated the complex nature of the cosmos in calendars through literature and on monuments through architecture. But everything changed when Galileo Galilei pointed his telescope towards the heavens and opened up the universe to humanity, no longer limited by the constraints of human anatomy. Human eye was no match for what could be seen through a well-crafted telescope. Details on the moon, close-up of other planets, and hundreds of thousands of stars that were unseen by human eyes were suddenly available to anyone with this relatively simple tool called telescope by the early 17th century. And over time, the telescopes got more and more powerful, leveraging cutting-edge science and technology and sometimes giving birth to new technology itself to satisfy the exploration of space. Well, we are not going to talk much about the invention of the telescope and its evolution leading to today's state-of-the-art professional-level telescopes on the ground and in space. As you can find many articles, videos and documentaries discussing extensively on this topic. I would recommend you to watch the documentary Eyes on the Skies, produced by European Southern Observatory, which explores many facets of telescope, starting from its invention to the modern-day state-of-the-art professional telescopes. You can find link in the description. As you know, amateur astronomers in the past contributed towards spreading of the knowledge of astronomy and so do in modern times. Be it astronomy education, sky observation or virtual sky software development, astronomy popularization nowadays is mostly dependent on non-professional astronomers, I mean amateur astronomers. So in this video, our focus would be on less discussed historical development and technological breakthroughs of amateur telescopes, and also the people behind it, their triumphs and challenges. This video is part of a series of videos covering various aspects of amateur telescopes, throwing light on historical development, their types, working principles, boiling down specifications, and also product reviews and much more to serve the needs of space enthusiasts. And all of this won't be possible without the support of Galaxy Technocom, an authorized dealer of amateur telescopes joining hands with SpaceTime, delivering products and services like never before in India. And generous contribution of my friend and fellow amateur astronomer Bharadwaj, who donated his equipment for education, outreach and research. So let's begin our journey into the space and time through the lens of amateur telescopes. If someone wanted a telescope before the 20th century, chances are that they had to make one by themselves, as commercial telescopes were expensive. If someone could afford to buy a telescope, the choice to buy one was easy, as one type of telescope predominated. It was likely a small refractor telescope of 2 to 3 inch in aperture, similar to the type of telescope that Galileo used, in which the light coming from a celestial object arrives in rays that are perfectly parallel and refracts through a front lens called an objective lens, similar to the lens of a magnifying glass, which converges the light to form an image at its focal point. But our eyes cannot see this image as the converged light at the focal point is not parallel, because the lens inside our eyes is designed to focus parallel rays to form an image on the retina. So we need one more lens that catches the light as it diverges away from the focal point and bends it back to a parallel rays, so that our eyes can refocus it on the retina to form an image that we actually see. The small second lens is called an eyepiece lens, as it processes the light so that our eye can see. In this process, notice how the telescope has taken all the light passing through the objective lens and compressed it down to a column of light that will pass through the pupil of the eye. Doing so, it is collecting way more light than our eyes to make a bright image, resolving more details in the image than our eye can see, and finally, treating us with a magnified image so we can see the additional details of an object of interest. All this can be achieved by just putting an objective lens similar to a magnifying glass and a smaller eyepiece lens together in a tube properly to make it into a telescope. That's pretty simple, right? But at this point, you might be thinking, why can't we just point magnifying glass towards the sky and observe celestial objects just like we magnify a text on a paper? Well, if you look at the lens of a magnifying glass, it's made of biconvex lens. That's part of two spherical lenses put together. When non-parallel diverged light coming from a closer object enters the lens from one side, then it gives off parallel rays on the other side that can be focused by our eyes, giving a magnified view of a part of the object close to its optical center. But when parallel light from far away objects enters into this lens from one side, it converges on the other side at its focal point, giving a blurred image. That is why a single magnifying glass is not suitable for looking at celestial objects. To do so, we need an extra lens such as an eyepiece to convert into a telescope, as we discussed before. As I mentioned, during the 1800s, the small refracting telescopes with 2 to 3 inch diameter of an objective lens were a popular choice of amateur astronomers. The main observing activities of amateurs with these telescopes were looking at the moon and planets, differentiating the colors of double stars, and scanning a handful of star clusters and nebulae, the birthplace of stars. A few advanced observers engaged in the more technical activity of measuring the relative positions of double stars and changing brightness of variable stars. One star among notable amateur astronomers from the 1800s was Gore, who began to study the sky with his binoculars and 3-inch refractor telescope while working in India as a railway engineer. His book, Southern Stellar Objects for Small Telescopes, was published in India in 1877. Later, he moved to Ireland and discovered several binary and variable stars. During the 19th century, recordings of observations by amateur astronomers were mostly done through hand drawings, much like Galileo. Astrophotography was taking baby steps even in professional astronomy. But by the end of 19th century, two amateur astronomers pioneered in the field of astrophotography who surpassed even professionals. They were Andrew Common and Isaac Roberts, who can be regarded as fathers of amateur astrophotography. Both were equipped with personal observatories with bigger telescopes. Look at their work, mainly capturing the details of Orion Nebula and Andromeda Nebula. Indeed, they were better than any photographs taken by professional astronomers at that time. Through early telescopes, Andromeda was seen as a fuzzy spot in the sky, and it was assumed to be a nebula of gas lying within our Milky Way galaxy. In 1888, amateur astronomer Isaac Roberts' photograph of Andromeda revealed its spiral structure for the first time, speculating for a distant galaxy separate from our home galaxy Milky Way, which raised the curiosity to investigate further. Ultimately, this hypothesis was shown to be true by Edwin Hubble in 1925. Now, Andromeda Nebula is known as Andromeda Galaxy, which is our closest galactic neighbor, sitting 2.5 million light years away. This shows what can be achieved with a dedicated hobby. Anyway, our inspiration doesn't stop here. We continue our journey through the lens of amateur telescopes into the next century. By early to mid 1900s, large refracting telescopes were available, but at a very high price. Bigger aperture means longer focal length. These huge 4 and 6 inch refractors by Unitron were as portable as the pillars of Stonehenge. Using this classic long focus with high magnification telescopes, amateurs helped to map the moon, resolve surface details of planets such as the drawings of Saturn made by an amateur, while some serious amateurs took additional effort and helped mapping thousands of variable stars. One of the notable amateurs during this period was Radha Gobinda Chandra, a pioneer of observational astronomy from India. In the early 1900s, with his 3 and 6 inch refractor telescopes, he observed close to 50,000 variable stars and became one of the first international members of American Association of Variable Star Observers. Lately, the amateur refractors reached to its limits by the mid-1900s, while making large lenses became a problematic, as the lens could deform due to its own weight, which is supported only on sideways. The large and thicker refracting lens further worsened the prismatic effect, which occurs due to the varying thickness of a lens that bends light of different wavelengths at various focal points, giving a defect called chromatic aberration. Then Newton comes to the rescue. Yes, you heard it right. Sir Isaac Newton's 17th century invention of a completely new way of designing a telescope suddenly became popular among amateurs for a number of reasons, which we will explore in the next episode. Until then, stay curious and think of getting your own small refractor telescope and unleash the hidden explorer in you. Links in the description. As always, thanks for giving your space and time.